Right, 10 o'clock, so I think it's time to start with a very brief introduction. First of all, good morning, everybody. Laura Ballerini speaking. And I am sincerely honored to introduce today's speaker, Giancarlo Ruocco, full professor of condensed matter physics at La Sapienza, Rome. I will just briefly highlight some of the research activities of Giancarlo, which will be then largely introduced from his own seminar, From Inelastic X-ray Scattering to Neuroscience. Giancarlo's research activity has focused mostly on the study of dynamics of disordered matter, from liquids to glasses, soft matter, and biological matter, by the use of different approaches, which are from experimental ones to numerical, and mostly these refers to molecular simulations and theoretical ones. Now, most recently, his activity has been directed towards the study of soft and biological matter, and in particular, targeting the development of new microscopy or ultramicroscopy techniques and their applications, successful applications to genuine biological problems, which includes neuroscience-related one, such as the approach to the early diagnosis of neurodegenerative diseases or the investigation of neural networks. Now, besides that, Giancarlo gained a large experience in coordinating research activities. He has been the director of the physics department at La Sapienza, Roma, and in the same university has been vice rector with a delegate to the research policy for several years. He is the recipient, and actually is the only one I know, of an ERC Synergy grant, and has been the proponent, and then from 2015, IIT scientist and coordinator of the Center for Life Nanoscience, CLNS, which is a laboratory of the Italian Institute of Technology, IIT, established in Rome. During his career, Giancarlo has been supervising around 30 PhD students. He has an impressive record of publications, but is also widely known as one of the pioneers in the development and implementation of spectroscopic instrumentations. Before I give the start to Giancarlo, I would like to remind you that the questions will be taken at the end of the seminar for organizative reasons, and you may raise hands or via the chat ask to be introduced for a question. And at the end of the talk, we will allow you to self-unmute yourself in the moment you are proposing a question. So please, Giancarlo.
Okay, thank you, Laura. Thanks to all of you to be here. And good morning, of course. As you can imagine, to me, it's the first e-talk. And okay, let's try this new experience. I will present briefly, I will say, my history in just one slide, which is made, I will say, in three parts. In the first part, in the first year of my career, I was studying, but I'm still studying, disordered matter, specifically dynamic of disordered matter, and as Laura said, mostly on the experimental side by the development of new and, let's say, problem-solving experimental techniques. Then there have been an interval where I dedicate my activity to university management, and of course I will not talk about this part. And then, since 2015, I'm trying to apply what I knew and what I has done in the past to the problem which can be of interest from other fields of science and specifically to neuroscience. Going on the detail on what I'm going to say, I will give you an example of my first career part about the acoustic excitation glasses, how they behave and why they are important. And then there are, in the list, at least three items related to my new activities. Don't think I will have the time to discuss all the three, or maybe I will go very quick about one of or two of them. So let's start. Let's start from this picture, which for now is empty, but is a sort of a plane where one can report the wavelength and the period or the time scale and the length scale of what is an acoustic excitation. This can be this diagram can be split, the first of all, in the space by some sort of discontinuity between how we can consider the matter as a continuum when the wavelength of the acoustic excitation we want to investigate is much larger than the interatomic distances. And then actually the sound waves, the acoustic wave, see this the matter as a continuum, and we can apply continuum elasticity theory. And another part where the granularity of the matter is important, so where we start to see excitation wavelength comparable to the interatomic intermolecular distances. Something can also be done in the time scale, because for most of the disorder matter, this is true, of course, for any system, but we have, for example, in the crystal region of time scale, which the system is frozen, and for the crystal, this is always true, but in a disorder system where the glass transition takes place, or where there are supercooled phenomena, the liquid can be supercooled, we have a line we distinguish between a sort of frozen, when the dynamics of the atoms is much slower than the period of the wavelength, of the acoustic wavelength, and another region where the dynamic of the atoms of the molecule is faster than the where the period of the acoustic excitation. This discontinuity line in the disorder system is fuzzy, is not a sharp line because of the glass transition phenomena, and therefore it can be seen as some temperature dependent splitting on the plane. So we have four region in this plane where we can use a different theory, a different approach. Of course, on the top left corner, we have the continuous theory of a non-dynamic or static system. Then we can have some molecular hydrodynamics to describe what happened in the lower left. And also we have to think to even more in, involved and complicated theory when introduce the granularity of the matter. In order to experimentally investigate the behavior of the acoustic wave in this region, in this plane, there are different instruments, or there were different instruments at the end of the last century. But if we put on this plane also the dispersion relation, which is expected for the acoustic wave, which means what is the frequency of the energy of the acoustic wave as a function of the exchange of momentum, which is 1/λ, basically, we see that there are a large part of the plane which is not explorable. We didn't have at the time any technique capable, for example, to measure acoustic excitation in glasses, and 5,000 meters per second is more or less in the range of the sound velocity in glasses. There are a large part of this plane which cannot be explored. And this comes my first activity, which has been together with Francesco Setti at ESRF, the development of a new technique, which has been called inelastic X-ray scattering, which is capable at least to start to close this gap between what is measurable and what is not measurable as far as the acoustic excitation in glasses. With this technique, I now go very quick, without entering too much in details, and what we have done is a matter of maybe 15 to 20 years of work. We have first demonstrating the existence of acoustic excitation in glasses at wavelength comparable with the interatomic distances. While on the continuum side, everything is clear, and both theory and experiment was done with the Brillouin light scattering, and the theory was on continuum mechanics, nothing were much known about what's happened when the wavelength of the acoustic excitation is comparable to the interatomic or intermolecular distance in the glasses. In this range, we start with the demonstrations that actually there is still exists acoustic excitation in disorder systems, a sort of phonon, which are concept defined in crystals in order system, has been extended to disorder system, to glasses. this excitation have an almost linear dispersion relation, which means that their frequency is proportional to 1 over lambda to the exchange moment of Q. And this is typical, of course, of the phonon in crystal, but we demonstrated that also in disorderless systems there are the same phenomena. But also then when the wavelength become equal to the interatomic distance, so the average mean interatomic distance in glasses, the dispersion relation become very similar to what's happening in a crystal. You have a first linear part, then you have an inflection point, a maximum, and then you go down with a minimum, which is in the crystal will be zero, with an excitation at zero frequency when you reach the first brilliant zone. But in the glasses, the brilliant zone is not too well defined, so you have a minimum and then another maximum, and so on and so forth. So the dispersion relation is similar to what's happening in a crystal, but keeping a varying information also on the structure of the glass of this other system. Okay, don't to enter in the matter of what is a boson peak, we bring us far away from the main road. And another crystal-like property is the existence of Unklapp process, which is again associated with the fact that there is a pseudo-brilliant zone, which is related to the first maximum, the SOK, the static structure factor. Another similarity with crystal. And if we move to think about, to look at the broadening of the excitation, in a phonon and a perfect crystal, this would be zero, at zero temperature, beside any harmonic effect. But we will show later that there are no anharmonic effect, no big anharmonic effect, which determines the broadening of this excitation. The broadening is small as small q, which means that you can see the excitation as a peak, as a well-defined peak in the dynamic structure factor. And the broadening is behaving as a q square, while the excitation frequency is linear with q, the broadening is proportional to q square. And this is true in a very broad range of q, of change of momentum. The broadening is t independent, which means it comes from the intrinsic property of the disorder, not from an harmonic effect. There are also transverse excitations, which is of course very well defined and very well known in crystals, but after a year of study we have fixed the point that also transverse excitation can exist in glasses and in supercooled liquid. And then other more subtle effects, like for example, the positive dispersion of the sound velocity, which means that sound velocity is not a constant at very small q, but before doing a turn down because of the interaction of, let's say, with when the wavelength become comparable with the interatomic distance, also in the continuum limit, when the wavelength is much larger than the interatomic distances, you have an effect of the disorder which induces a change in a sound velocity, which in this case is a positive dispersion. If you look at a plot like this one, you see that in a crystal you should expect for the sound velocity constant and then goes down because of the wavelength become comparable to the interatomic distance. In glasses, you see that there is first an increase and then the crystal light decrease. And to study this increase has been a very, at the beginning, difficult task, but nowadays it's well established that this is a true features of the dynamic of disorder system. This is the first summary of this part, but just to say that my, let's say, experimental and instruments development activity has been over. From this point, and I want to show you this plot, which is again the broadening of the excitation of function of Q in a log block scale, where these dashed lines are the Q square dependence, but the Q square dependence in measured in the IQ region, which has been exposed by IXS, is not really consistent with what has been measured in Brillouin light scatter. and to try to, and what you see is exactly the gap in the QE plane, which is associated with the fact that this excitation in a certain region cannot be measured. In order to fill the gap, in 2000, in an on-campus spectrometer, which is a Brillouin light spectrometer extended to use ultraviolet radiation, which was established in L'Aquila, where I was at the time, start to fill this gap, allowing to measure a few more points on this plot. And then a second step, maybe more important step, is the design of, again, ultraviolet, but more towards the high energy side, spectrometer, which is now working at Elettra and is conducted by Claudio Masciovecchio since that time. And with this new instrument, we were able to see that there are a Q to the fourth regime in the middle between this high frequency regime measured by XS and this Brillouin light scattering. This Q to the fourth is the Rayleigh scattering, which takes place in any sort of system. So in this regime, you can use a continuum approximation to describe the sound wave excitation, but you have to introduce the existence of scattering center, which exactly like the phenomenon of the blue sky, give rise to the Q to the fourth, which is lambda to the minus four scattering, of the, in this case, of acoustic excitation. The gap is still there, it must be filled again, but if we look at the situation, basically today is a little bit more advanced with respect to 20 or 30 years ago. There is still a small gap which needs to be filled, and new experimental techniques are called for. Okay, just to say that all the features that we have measured in the last 20 years is now more or less framed in a theory, which is called heterogeneous viscosity theory, which are able to describe the behavior of the acoustic excitation and of the density of states of the acoustic excitation in the whole omega Q range. There are very, very many people to thank in this part of my life, because you can imagine these 20 years of activities, but I just mentioned maybe the five person where I have them for this part of the story, the strongest interaction in this period. Okay, let's move to what we have done, what I have done maybe 10 years later, starting from 2015. And this is the first story that I want to tell you very briefly, not spending too much time, but just to introduce this field of activity, which is not really related to neuroscience, but started from a neuroscience problem. We were studying neural network, we were studying artificial neural network, and then we moved to study a natural neural network, which is a neural network of the CNN. In doing that, we enter in contact with a sort of a strange thing. A group of scientists in Japan discovered that there was a strong correlation between the presence of Anisakis worm in the area of the body where some gastric tumor were present. So on surgery for gastric tumor, they discover often the presence of Anisakis worm. And starting from this observation, which was more or less a serendipity observation, this group started to study the C. elegans, and we do the same, because there was the idea that worms, not really Anisakis, because it was very difficult to manage, but the C. elegans, could have the capability of, let me say, sniff the presence of some tumor metabolite. Okay, C. elegans, for who don't know him, is a sort of a model hydrogen atom for the biology, is a simple pluricellular organism. It's very small. It's 15 micron diameter and 1 meter long. Its body is transparent, which is perfect for doing a microscopy experiment. And from the point of view of the connectoma, he has a fixed number of cells, but also a fixed number of neurons. So they are very small numbers, 300 neurons. And also the connections, the synapses connecting these neurons are no more than 7,000. And all these neurons are known, and all these synapses are known. And from electron microscope, the size of this synapse or the connection has been measured. Therefore, an idea of what is the strength of the connection is already known for this, let's say, natural, not much complicated, but natural connector. What I have to say is that not the sign of this connection are known, which is not yet known if the neuron are the presynaptic neuron act as excitatory or inhibitory neurons for the postsynaptic one. This is the only point that remain to be found in this organisms. And doing this study on the C. elegans, doing this means measuring the chemiotaxis, which means the capability of these small worms to recognize the presence of a tumor metabolite in some fluids. In yellow, you see the chemiotaxis index positive means that the worm is attracted by the fluid of, in this case, from urine coming from breast cancer, lung cancer, and other maybe more exotic kind of cancer person. And the blue, which you have a chemotaxis in a negative chemotaxis index, indicates repulsion with respect to controls. So blue are control and yellow are many different tumors patients. From this picture, one can immediately recognize the capability of the worm to have attraction towards some unknown metabolite of the tumors fluids, in this case urine. We started from this point, and we, instead of measuring chemiotaxis, we were concentrating on the possibility of measuring its attraction by measuring its neural activity. So to make short long story, one can, in a freely moving worm, we can locate the brain, we can make a brain location with high precision, and then by allowing the neurons of interest to express some calcium indicator, and one can do in vivo calcium imaging of the neural activity. When you see the signal of fluorescence coming from this calcium indicator, it means that the neurons is active. These C. elegans neurons are not really spiking neurons, are only activity, which is graded activity with a change, slow change in the brain membrane potential, but still one can measure the change in fluorescence activity. And measuring so the specific neuron which is responsible for the chemiotaxis, which is one olfactory neuron which exposes a part of its synapses to the external world, one can say, okay, this neuron is active, the worm is smelling something, or it's not smelling nothing of interest for him. And therefore, okay, this is a kind of experiment pointing on this specific neuron. And after the exposure to the urine, which is given indicated by the flash, there is an increase of neural activity from the calcium indication. And we have developed different chips where the worm are stored, different worm are measured simultaneously. We can have a large statistic allowing from the large number of neurons and the relatively easy possibility of doing this measurement. And we have compared the neural index, which is how much this chemiotaxis responsible neuron react with respect to the real chemiotaxis, which is a measurement of the macroscopic behavior of the worm. In blue and gray, again, the answer to the healthy people, to controls. And in red, and you see the response to tumors, urine. In this case, we concentrate on breast tumor in order to select one specific case. The information we get from this plot and that is that, okay, the chemotaxis is confirmed by the neural activity measured by fluorescence. And at the same time, that there was a much more clear answer from the fluorescence, from the calcium imaging with respect to chemotaxis. So we have a way which is not only faster and cheaper to measure the activity of the worm, but also much more efficient and efficacious. What we want to do now is to reduce all this story for different kind of tumor. We are working pancreas, and we are working for the time being is pancreas. We plan to go to other kind of tumors, and also to set up a small portable instrument, which is capable after the let's say administration of urine to this small chip to make measurements of the presence or less of brain metabolite or tumor metabolite, building a small sensor, which should be easy to handle and cheap and not invasive. So you can imagine to measure the presence or less of breast cancer, not doing any invasive test would be of great appreciability from the population. Of course, this is the more technical part of the story, but from the basic science point of view, we are also trying to search which is the metabolite which is responsible for the neural activity of those specific neurons by investigating which kind of receptors it express on its membrane and what kind of molecules are present in the urine, doing mass spectroscopy analysis and so forth. So this research line have both an applicative side and also a more basic side, more basic point of view. A third activity in my new life is refer to something which is how to answer to this question, how to translate the knowledge acquired in the first part of my activity towards something new. I did 20 years of research on the Brillouin scattering. Brillouin means measuring the sound velocity of acoustic excitation and the property, the mechanical properties of acoustic excitation. How we can use this to for biological problem, from problem of biological origin. And this is what I call a new dimension in microscopy, because at the end of this few slides, you will see that nowadays it is possible to make images with a standard confocal microscope resolution, but not measuring the optical property or the fluorescent property of the system you are looking at, but measuring the mechanical property using the Brillouin scattering. Biomechanical is an important branch of biology because it's now clear that there are different biomechanical property of cells, sub-part of the cell, associated for different pathologies. For example, just to say one, the tumor cell are much less stiff than the normal one, and this allows these cells to deform themselves and pass the endothelial barrier. So the cancer cell diffuse, they are more mobile with respect to the normal cell because they are much less stiff. And this is just to say a feeling of what is the importance of biomechanics, which is a rather new field in biology. In order to go away with the biomechanics, one have to measure force and deformation. And of course, if you want to measure deformation, the best way would be to apply efforts and to look in some way how the system is deformating. And this measure, the ratio between the applied force and the deformation, or vice versa, is an information about the elastic modulus, about real part of the elastic modulus and the imaginary part of the elastic modulus, which is a viscosity of the cell as a wall. In all this known technique about measuring forces and deformation, one has to apply contact force. And maybe the most used and most known is AFM, the atomic force microscopy, where you touch with a tip the surface and membrane of the cell, and you measure how much they deform, how much they react. All these known systems are invasive. You have to touch the cell, the tissue, whatever you want to measure. Then there are other problems. You cannot do really 3D imaging because you are working on what's happened on the wall cell when you touch here. And therefore, you lost both the 3D capability and you also lost the possibility to have a subcellular resolution. Brillouin microscopy is a way of solving this problem, this kind of problem, and go away. Because first of all, it's contactless. You just shine light on the system and it's label free because the Brillouin scattering is an intrinsic property of the matter, whatever they are. And you don't need to put any fluorophore or any new labeling. You have the space resolution of the microscope that you're using to shine the light and to collect the light, and therefore you have 3D capability with very, very high spatial resolution. This is why I would say this opens a new dimension in imaging. Brillouin microscopy is the first step of his life. Its life, but it's I think already showing many, many important capabilities. I don't know if I have time to go to the detail of what I would like to just to show why you can, by Brillouin scattering, measuring the elastic property of the system, but I think I can jump this part, and some of you is important, is interested, I will, of course, come back on this. Just to say that shining light, coherent light on a sample and collecting the scattering light with the same optics that we have used to shine the light, we can measure the spectrum of the scattered light, and the spectrum of the scattered light, this is just on the top left, just an example, bring information on the peak position and on the width of the excitation. We have discussed it in the first part of this talk already, these names, this parameter. But what is important now is that the frequency of the excitation is related to the elastic modulus and the real part of the elastic modulus, while the broadening of the excitation is related to the imaginary part of the elastic modulus, which is the viscosity. So with this kind of measurement, we can have access to both stiffness, in some sense, to the elastic modulus, and to the viscosity of the medium. And this, we will see later, is an important feature of the biological samples. There is a lot of discussion about what kind of elastic model, because you know there are different definition and different kind of elastic model. They are all related one to the other, there are just two independent elastic modulus. With Brillouin, we measure the what is called longitudinal modulus, while with the AFM, atomic force motor microscopy, we use the Young modulus. And the two are very different because the longitudinal modulus is a modulus which measures the reaction of the system, the deformation of the system, changing the volume of the system, so changing the density, while the Young modulus is a deformation which does not change the volume. And this, of course, makes a huge difference in terms of value. The longitudinal modulus is in the range of gigapascal for most material, and the Young modulus is the sixth order of magnitude smaller. There is also a discussion about the frequency dependence of this modulus. because you can do the measurement at constant deformation, or you can measure these models by applying an periodic deformation at certain frequency. If you stay at small frequency, zero frequency, basically, you measure what is called zero frequency moduli. And if you go through glass transition, the viscoelasticity property has to take into account. I have no time to show all the detail. Viscoelasticity means that, sorry, I got there. Viscoelasticity means that there is a transition between what is the low frequency value of the moduli and the high frequency one, and the transition point is exactly on the green line which I show on the first slide. So when the wave, elastic wave, sees the system as a continuum or as a continuum, or static continuum, the frozen continuum, or at you see the mobility of the atom and a relaxation process between the atom and the monocle take place. This is all just to say that in doing measurement as a function of frequency, one can study this transition and also gather information about the relaxation time and the way the atoms and the molecule are moving inside the samples you are measuring. This has been very short overview and of the phenomena, but now we go to imaging. The first imaging traced back to 15 years ago and was done with a tabletop system, and this was really hard matter. It was a silica glass covered with silicon, and just to show with a very poor resolution, 20 micron resolution, that one is able to make some map of the acoustic property of a matter surface. Nowadays, the resolution has been pushed to the level of the, as I said, confocal microscope resolution. So the transversal resolution is 300 nanometer. The Z resolution is close to 1 micron, maybe less. And measurement can be done with a very small amount of power, less than 10 milliwatt, which is perfectly compatible with the biomatter, with cell or tissue. And the drawback for the time being is a very long acquisition time. We are at the level of 100 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds for point. To acquire such a spectrum, we need 10 milliseconds of integration time. And you can imagine that to collect a map like that, you need hours. Three quick examples. The first one is related to what's happened in a tissue. And this is a blood vessel, a cross-section of the blood vessel seen by just phase contrast imaging and Bethe-Uhlen microscopy. Each point of this image has been collected, for each point is collected a spectrum. For the spectrum, one extracts information about the spectral parameter and can make a color map, in this case of the elastic, real part of the elastic modulus, as a function of the position. And you can easily recognize that the image looks the same, but here you have information of the, let's say, index of refraction or contrast or index of refraction. On the left side, you have information on the mechanical property, which is really a new information for biomatter. And then you can study what's happened if you have arteriosclerotic situation, how the level of moduli change and going from health to arteriosclerotic vessel. And this is the map you have where you can see the difference between a healthy part of the cell on the endothelial cell and the deposition of a cholesterol. This work was just a proof in the sense that we are capable to measure elastic property of the matter in a situation where different methods can be used. For instance, a marker of lipids or for instance, a marker of collagen will give you the same information that we gather with this system. But more important is if we go at the cellular level. These are the first study of in the case of cells. And this is again a test just to see whether the presence of this molecule, leukotriene, which is known to decrease the cellular stiffness. And what we measured is exactly a change in the modulus from control to cell which has been treated with this molecule. And then finally, I want to spend 1 minute on this, which has been a real application to a new problem. It's not a control, but is a measurement done on HeLa cell, where they are pushed to overexpress by genetic modification to overexpress this FUS mutated protein. The FUS protein is a protein which is important in SLA, in a pathology, in ALS pathology. And one of the hypotheses is that the mutation of this protein give rise to a situation where the stress granules are granules which are formed by the cell, like a protein aggregation formed by the cell after this administration of a kind of stress. In this case, has been used arsenide. And the green fluorescent tags here indicate exactly the FUS protein. And after the stress, the cell produces these protein aggregates, which are localized perinuclear. The blue is DAPI for the nuclear finding. And the green indicates the presence of FUS protein perinuclearly. In this case, you have the control, so normal FUS protein. And in this case, you have the mutated FUS protein. You don't see much difference between the fact that this cell produces its granules, which are located close to the nuclei. But if you go to measure the mechanical property, which was, of course, not possible in fluorescence imaging or in transmission imaging, if you go to measure the mechanical property of these granules, you don't see much effect with respect to the nuclei in normal protein, but you see that there is an increase of the moduli, of the elastic moduli, of the stiffness of this stress granule, which indicates that the presence of the mutated protein make harder the mechanics of this grain, of this stress granule, and give information also, yeah, I have not reported here the plot, on the fact that the viscosity is increasing. So basically you have some stress granule which are more stable with respect to the non-mutated protein, which is a strong indication of the fact that the stress granule will not dissolute quick enough after the removing of the stress. And this is supposed to be one of the possible origin of the ALS pathology. At least that part of the pathology which is associated with the mutation of this protein. This, I think, is more or less a few percent of the total patient where this mutation is found. But at least for this part of the specific genetic mutation, it seems to be one possible origin of the pathology. And using this new microscopy, it has been possible at least to give some hint on the really mechanical origin of this, let's say, protein aggregation behavior. I have to say that part of the Synergy grant is the Synergy project is based on the search of the mechanical property of protein aggregation, which is important not only in ALS pathology, but also in many other neurodegenerative pathologies, as we will see soon in the next slide. And we go to, in the last minutes, to another optical microscopy technique, which is called scattering assisted microscopy. Very quickly, the limitation in resolution in a microscopy is basically associated in the fact that you are using light with a certain wavelength. And because of diffraction, you cannot create a spot of light using a certain wavelength smaller than a fraction of lambda. The maximum concentration of light, the size of the spot is 1/2 times the index of refraction on the media and the numerical aperture. Numerical aperture is a sort of jargon used by microscopists to define the maximum angle that the sample, where the sample sees the origin of the light. And this is very easy to understand from the physical point of view. If you have a low numerical aperture, you are using a small span of angle, the small span of the K vector. Therefore, you are using, you are very concentrated in the Fourier space, and when you do the Fourier transform of the image, you get a very broad image in real space. On the contrary, when you increase the numerical aperture, you increase the number of K vector you are using to set up what you like. So it would be a delta function, and increasing the number of K vector means that you reduce the size of the spot in the real space. The higher the numerical aperture, the smaller is the spot. This is the standard for microscopies. And this is just the physical origin of this, very, very quick way of seeing from the physical point of view of this law. Numerical also means working distance. If you have an objective of a lens which has a certain finite dimension, the far you go from the lens, the smallest is the angle, and therefore the worst is a numerical aperture. Indeed, high numerical aperture objective works for very small working distance, fraction of millimeter for the best performing objective. Why this is a problem? It's a problem because we want to reach, and now I will tell you why, we want to reach high numerical aperture, but working from far away, with a long working distance. In which way we can reach this goal? We use a speckled field. So what is a speckled field? A speckled field is what the interference between beams coming from, if you have a coherent source, which shine light on a rough surface. Each point of the surface scatter or reflect light with a reach a certain point with a distance, with a path can be such that the sum of the different paths of which this point have a negative interference if you have dark point, or a sum of positive interference if you have bright point. And if you see what's happened when you go far away, you get this sort of pattern. But if you look close, I mean, so if you put your screen close to the scattering surface, you observe that the size of the speckle is smaller. And the closer you go in the what is called near field, speckled field, the closer you go, the smaller are the speckled field, because the different point on the screen sees the source from a largest angle. It's exactly as in the case of an objective, you are using a small portion of the Fourier space. Here you're using the largest portion of the Fourier space, and one can measure the size of the speckle even if you go very close at the limit on the roughness scattering surface. What's happening if you go inside the scattering surface? Okay, it's very understandable at this point. If you go inside the scattering samples, you get at the smallest speckle as possible. And the numerical aperture, instead of being 1 or 1.4 for the better objective, become 4 pi, become 10 times larger than the what is obtainable with a standard, not really standard, with a good microscope objective. Shall we do, shall we use this property to do super resolution? Let's suppose to put a fluorescent bead inside the sample, the scattering sample. You can have these beads, very small beads, in a positive speckle or in a negative speckle. If it is a negative speckle, it will not emit fluorescence. If it is in the positive, it will emit. We have developed a system based on this trick, which means that you send on your sample, which is a highly scattering sample with some fluorescence inside, the field, the laser field, but it's a laser field where you're using a digital mirror device, you can change the phase of the different portion of the beam. And therefore, you can try to maximize the fluorescence coming from the beads that you're put inside the scattering sample by changing the switching on and off the 1 million of mirrors that take place, which are part of the digital mirror device. And therefore, you can optimize the intensity on one point. But once you have optimized the intensity, and you can think about the fact that you can optimize the intensity without any spatial resolution, because you can collect the fluorescent light coming from the sample from everywhere. But once you have optimized the intensity, you have maximized the intensity, you know that there is a speckle on that point. And base is very system from now on, very simple, similar to what's happening in a storm kind of microscope. To make a short, long story, we were able to measure with the resolution of in this case, is the test where the objective was a 25 millimeter length lens with a, which would have a 4 micron resolution. We get a resolution of 1 micron. So we can, using this method, reduce the spot size by a factor of 4. But more important, as I said, we have done this using a 25 millimeter length lens. Why this number 25 millimeter is important. And now we go to the last few slides. Because our aim is to measure the presence of protein aggregation in the retina of humans. The retina is a part of the central nervous system, which is accessible from outside, optically accessible from outside, but if you are using optics with more than 25 millimeter, which is the diameter of the eye. If we were able to measure from such a distance with a spatial resolution of, let's say, 200 nanometer, we were able to detect the presence of protein aggregation. Okay, I don't know, and I think nobody knows whether the presence of beta amyloid tau aggregates is an effect of a cause of the Alzheimer's disease. But of course, there is a strong correlation between these two phenomena, let's say, pathology and the presence of these aggregates. Therefore, the presence of aggregates is an indication of the pathology. And from a preliminary study made by Silvia D'Angelo Antonio and his group in genetically modified mice for expressing the similar pathology that the human is Alzheimer's disease. It was possible to measure the presence of these aggregates with increases with time of life of the mice. And if the symptoms appear around the 60 weeks, we are able to see the presence of these aggregates in even the 10th week. So very, very early with respect to appearance of the cognitive impairments in the mice. If we were able to measure aggregate of size around 1 micron, we would be able to anticipate the presence of the pathology in human by a very long time, which is not only important for early diagnosis, but also, I think, more important for the development and the test, the trial for drugs. If we succeed in doing this job, we will present a method to measure the presence and the grow with time of the size of the aggregates, which is, of course, very important to detect and pathology, but also test the effect of possible drug on the reduction of this aggregate growth. Okay, I will just stop here because this is our work now, just to develop the instrument. And we are making tests with the artificial eye in this very moment. We will go immediately to animal, big animal eye, in order to simulate as better as possible the human eye. And then we will, next year, 21, we think we are able to move to humans for a real test of this part. Let me thanks all the person, I'm not going through all of them, but all the people which are working in this last three projects. They all belong to the CLNS, the Center for Life Nanoscience, which had the honor of direct from 5 years also. And of course, thank you all for the attention, and let me apologize. I think I go a little bit longer than expected, but thanks again. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Giancarlo. It's a little bit weird without the applause at the end. It was extremely interesting. The timing was okay. So we are now ready to take questions. And by raised hand, I see that Michele Giuliano has raised the hand at the moment. So please, Michele, go ahead with your question. You can unmute yourself.
Thank you very much. My name is Michele Giuliano. It was a very nice presentation. I would like to ask you to comment on the renewed interest on the mechanical correlate of electrical phenomena in excitable cells, in neurons, particularly mechanical correlate of action potentials. And I was impressed by the fact that for the Brillouin imaging, you are relatively fast, so 10 milliseconds per point. I wonder whether you envisage in the future the possibility of having a label-free optical imaging of the membrane potential with your technique.
Okay, you say really fast, but it's 10 milliseconds per point is, I think, is very slow. And one of our game in this part of the story is to change the spectrometer part in order not to use, now we are using an interferometer basically. We want to go to use some Brillouin simulated Brillouin technique. We should gain a factor of 100, at least on paper. This is what we expect. And once we reach the level of 0.1 millisecond per point, we can think to do what you are asking, because we can not making a real whole image, but at least a small portion of the image in 1 millisecond, let's say. And in that case, we can follow the change in the rigidity of the elastic moduli of the membrane during the action potential. I think it's not possible right now because 10 milliseconds is too much. But I foresee that in like a couple of years, something can be done in that direction.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. So Giuseppe Legname, please go ahead and unmute yourself.
Good morning. I really enjoyed the talk. And I have a technical question. How long is the acquisition time for the eye diagnosis?
In that case, what we need is optimizing with a DMD. A DMD is made out of 1 million of mirrors. And 1 million of mirrors, but each of the mirrors can be moved with a time scale of the order of 1 microsecond. So I can say that in this optimization, we use a standard Monte Carlo optimization part. And by experience, a range of 100 steps is enough. So we can acquire an image about 100 microseconds. And in order to get the whole image, we needed to maximize different fluorophore in the system. Therefore, to be short, our plan is to make first a large low resolution scan of the retina in order to identify the points of interest where the fluorophore is. And then we concentrate on the fluorophore, and in the range of 1 millisecond, we should be able to have information on the site. So the idea is to have a more or less a standard or a little bit better than standard imaging of the retina, select the region of interest where some protein aggregation is found, concentrate of the region, and collect in 1 millisecond or few milliseconds the image in that side in order to measure the size of the protein aggregation. And the important point of this technique is that we can measure the size as a function of time, as I say. So the person, the patient, can come back after a few months and we can reach the same point and measure the size of the protein aggregation after a few months as a function of time. So to be short, I will say a few milliseconds would be the total integration time to measure the size of one protein aggregation.
That's great. But maybe one limitation may be that you wouldn't be able to provide the identity of the protein aggregate, meaning that there are many overlaps between neurodegenerative diseases. So you may not be able to discriminate A-beta from other aggregates, right?
Okay, for the time being, the point, of course, I went too fast. We need a fluorophore, which links the protein aggregation. So we are not basing of the autofluorescence. We are putting some fluorophore. For the time being, we are using curcumin for the simplest reason, which is allowed to put curcumin in the eye. So it's already FDA approved. And curcumin is, I have a high affinity for any kind of aggregation where beta sheet are present. Therefore, for the time being, we are not able to distinguish between tau and A beta, but we are not even capable to distinguish from A beta and synuclein. So for the time being, you are right. We are not capable of say, to the patient if you suffer of Parkinson or Alzheimer disease. But another part of our job, I have not time to discuss everything, and another part of our work is to find some fluorophore which is specific for a specific protein aggregation. We have to say, I can anticipate that we have already found a possible candidate for the tau protein from the tau tangle. But of course, this is under test in vitro, and we don't have the permission to test it on humans. For the time being, for humans, we plan to use curcumin, which is the only possible. And then we hope that someone else will take the story and develop. So, of course, it's not our aim, it's not in our capability, it's not in our interest to go to the trials. We want to develop the techniques, and we hope that others will take over and go with the trial story. Okay. But you are right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Paul Eppenstall.
Hi, thank you. That was a fascinating talk. I particularly found interesting your use of C. elegans as a diagnostic tool. Have you considered using a genetic screen in C. elegans to try and identify receptors and metabolites?
No, we have no such experience in the lab.
Okay, but that's traditionally this is the way one would find receptors, and it may be quite an easy way to make the assay more cell-based.
What we have tried to do, and there is maybe one paper also, is to use the structure of some of the receptor of this. The point is that, if I understand it correctly, is that while in the mammals, each neurons have a specific receptor for a chemical, in C. elegans, these animals express many different receptors in each neurons. It has very small number of neurons, and it must live only using the smell. You have no eyes, so you have no hair. The mechanical sensor is very poor. So all the life of C. elegans is driven by chemical and is driven by the olfactory system. The olfactory system counts 20 neurons, and with the 20 neurons, it must recognize many, many different molecules. So in each neuron, it has many different receptors. Some of them are similar to mammal receptor, where the structure is known. And we have selected those receptors of C. elegans, which is similar and where the structure is known, and with some standard pocket search code, pocket search software, we are trying to find which are the molecules among the ones that we have identified by mass spectroscopy, which one of them are capable to link this receptor. But it's more or less to find, to go to fish. So we don't have any systematic way of doing this job. It's not in our capability. Of course, any collaboration is open from this point of view.
Right, good, thank you.
Well. Non ti si sente, Laura.
Sorry about that. Mm-hmm. I was muted. Very nice to have a large audience and be completely muted. Sorry about that. I got distracted. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if there are other questions and if you there is time for that, another 5-7 minutes if you wish. Otherwise, we can leave Giancarlo to rest a little bit before the next meeting. If there are no additional points to be raised. Paul, you raise hand again.
Yeah, thanks, Laura. Just one more question. I was just wondering whether you'd compared the Brillion microscopy with FRET sensors for the mechanical properties.
No, I miss you, sorry.
Sorry, I'll try it again.
Paul disappeared.
Say something about Brillion microscopy, but I missed the question.
Yeah, Paul, we can't hear you anymore. If you want, you can write the question on the chat and then I read it for you.
FRET sensing versus Brillion microscopy. Giuliano wrote something, but
Michele, unmute yourself. If you got the question of Paul, you can.
Yeah, yes, I think he was. Paul was asking about whether you tried the FRET sensing. I think he wanted to, if possible, to compare with the Brillion microscopy. If this is what I got from Paul.
In principle, Brillion microscopy is a add-on of any confocal microscope. So one can do the same imaging and with FRET, this is no problem. We didn't do that because we are concentrating on developing a technique, but I don't see any problem on doing that. So we can compare the same image on the same sample on the same microscope, because as I said, Brillion is just a port on a standard confocal microscope.
Okay, yes, Paul confirmed that this was the question. chatting.
So we didn't do that, but it's definitely possible to go in this direction.
Okay. Thank you again. Right, so I try again. If these are all the questions, we can leave you a 10 minutes, 15 minutes rest, and then later on we start the next meeting. Thank you again. Thank you again, and thank you very much for your talk.
Attention. Bye bye.
Thank you.